This European Hematology Association Virtual Congress highlighted relevant news in multiple myeloma. In the upfront setting, well, in the management of newly diagnosed myeloma patients, we had the opportunity to see some data coming from new trials conducted, for example, in patients with a high risk cytogenetic abnormalities. And this is the case for bortezomib, lenalidomide, and dexamethasone plus the monoclonal antibody elotuzumab. And surprisingly, elotuzumab is not able to overcome the poor prognosis of the presence of high-risk cytogenetic abnormalities. Another study also conducted in a high-risk in patients with newly diagnosed myeloma patients at high risk evaluated the role of carfilzomib, the second-generation protease inhibitor, in combination with lenalidomide and dexamethasone and isatuximab, the anti-CD38 monoclonal antibody. And although the sample size is rather small right now, the results were quite promising, and maybe this quadruple combination can potentially overcome the good prognosis of the presence of high-risk cytogenetic abnormalities. In the treatment of newly diagnosed myeloma patients, but in the elderly population, non-eligible for autologous stem cell transplantation, we had some data about ixazomib, the oral protease inhibitor, evaluated as maintenance. So after whatever induction based on protease inhibitor, IMID or PI plus IMID, patients were randomized to receive ixazomib as protease inhibitor of oral administration versus placebo. And the trial met its primary endpoint, meaning that ixazomib as maintenance prolonged the progression-free survival in comparison with placebo. And from my personal point of view, I think that this is an excellent opportunity to extend the duration of the response in this population through the protease inhibition with ixazomib. And also, this drug opens the door to be combined with monoclonal antibodies or immunomodulatory drugs. If we move to the relapse and refractory setting, in early relapses, we have a late-breaking abstract presented by Professor Moreau from Nantes based on a new combination, carfilzomib and dexamethasone plus the monoclonal antibody isatuximab, evaluated in the phase 3 randomized trial IKEMA. The control arm was carfilzomib and dexamethasone. Patients included in this study were relapsed and refractory myeloma patients after 1 to 3 prior lines of therapy, and the addition of isatuximab to carfilzomib and dexamethasone resulted into a significant benefit in terms of progression-free survival with a hazard ratio of 0.5, and this benefit was sustained across the different group of patients. Also important to remark the high overall response rate, almost 90%, with a complete response rate for patients receiving carfilzomib, dexamethasone, and isatuximab over 30%, with a quite significant proportion of patients achieving minimal residual disease negative. And the toxicity profile was also quite acceptable. And this means that carfilzomib, dexamethasone, plus isatuximab will be maybe a new standard of care in relapsed and refractory myeloma patients. In this same population, the Boston study showed positive results also for a new combination, selinexor, an oral drug inhibiting the exporting one, in combination with bortezomib and dexamethasone. And this combination prolonged also the progression-free survival in comparison with bortezomib and dexamethasone alone. And the benefit was quite sustained across the different group of patients, especially patients with deletion 17p. And definitely this trial also put in context how this drug can be evaluated in patients with this cytogenetic abnormality. But the benefit was also quite evident in elderly patients older than 65 years, as well as those patients treated with immunomodulatory drugs as part of the first line of therapy. So this is another phase 3 randomized trial that has been presented at EHA, and I would like to remark here. And if we move to late advanced stage of the disease, so patients in third line and beyond, some sub-analysis based on Pomdex plus bortezomib or Pomdex plus isatuximab have been presented, but I would like to highlight the monoclonal antibodies targeting BCMA, because this is something new, and different updates coming from the conjugated monoclonal antibody belantamab mafodotin, and I would like to highlight the higher efficacy so far reported when this monoclonal antibody has been combined with bortezomib and dexamethasone or the checkpoint inhibitor pembrolizumab, as well as some sub-analysis reported in patients with some degree of renal impairment or high-risk cytogenetic abnormalities. And following with BCMA as target, we had the opportunity to see some abstracts with T-cell engager or bispecific monoclonal antibodies targeting BCMA in heavily pretreated myeloma patients with encouraging results. Finally, I would like to highlight the CAR-Ts targeting BCMA, the KARMA pivotal trial, as well as the EVOLVE trial and the CARTITUDE trial. And these three clinical trials have been conducted in patients with myeloma after at least 5 or 6 prior lines of therapy, and a significant proportion of patients presenting with extramedullary disease and high tumor burden. And definitely the overall response rate, the complete response rate, the minimal residual disease negativity rate has been impressive from my point of view for all of them. If we consider that the population included in this study will result in an overall response rate of 30% with conventional agents. And in this trial, we had the opportunity to see overall response rate over 80% in all of them, with a complete response rate ranging from 30 up to 45%. So these results are impressive. The only problem is the duration of the response, because after CAR-T, the durability of the response is not very long, and this is something in which we have to continue investigating in order to extend the durability of the response previously achieved. From the safety point of view, CAR-T is shown to be manageable, with a cytokine release syndrome occurring in almost all patients, as well as a neurological toxicity in some patients and hematological toxicity. But definitely, I think that this European Hematology Association virtual congress put in context how many new combinations are emerging for the management of relapsed and refractory myeloma patients, and also how these combinations can move earlier on, even in the upfront setting, and definitely this is going to contribute to improve the overall survival of our patients with multiple myeloma. Teclistamab is a bispecific duobody monoclonal antibody targeting BCMA, but at the same time redirects T lymphocytes to the tumor niche. So this means that this bispecific monoclonal antibody is going to induce the cytotoxicity through the activation of the T lymphocytes. Teclistamab has been evaluated in a series of 76 relapsed and refractory myeloma patients after at least 6 prior lines of therapy. 84% of the patients were 3 drug class refractory, meaning that they were refractory to proteasome inhibitors, immunomodulatory drugs, and anti-CD38 monoclonal antibodies. And a significant proportion of patients had extramedullary disease as well as high-risk cytogenetic abnormalities. This is a phase 1 study, meaning that patients were included in different cohorts receiving different doses. Efficacy was dose-dependent, and if we concentrate on the group of patients receiving the highest dose so far reported, the overall response rate was of approximately 70%, with more than 50% of the patients achieving VGPR. In addition, some patients, quite a significant proportion of patients who responded, were triple drug class refractory, and in fact, some of them were even penta refractory. Some patients, even achieving complete response, achieved the minimal residual disease negative, what is important. The follow-up is quite short right now, so median duration of the response or median progression of survival has not been reached yet, and there is an additional cohort of patients that are being treated now receiving a higher dose, 720 micrograms per kilo, and the data are not matured yet. This put in context that these efficacy results are preliminary, and maybe they can be better when these new cohorts of patients have mature results. This monoclonal antibody today is given of IV administration, but important to note that the subcutaneous administration is being also evaluated in some patients, so maybe the final route of administration can be subcutaneous, what is much more convenient for patients. From the safety point of view, as this is a bispecific monoclonal antibody redirecting T cells to the tumor niche, these T lymphocytes are going to be activated, meaning that cytokine release syndrome is a potential adverse event that occurred in 56% of the patients, but in all of them, it was only grade 1 and 2, and no patient developed grade 3 cytokine release syndrome. Hematological toxicity also were reported, grade 3, 4 neutropenia or thrombocytopenia in approximately 1/3 of the patients, although the frequency of infections was quite low, approximately 19% of the patients. And some patients also developed neurotoxicity, always following cytokine release syndrome, but it resulted in almost all patients. So I would say that if we put efficacy and safety together, I think that the results of teclistamab in this first in human phase 1 clinical trial are encouraging, because the safety profile is acceptable, efficacy is quite encouraging. Some patients continue ongoing in the trial, and the clinical development is ongoing. And definitely, I think that the teclistamab, as it occurs for other T-cell engagers or bispecific monoclonal antibodies, will be incorporated to the treatment landscape of our patients with multiple myeloma. Yes, there are other bispecific monoclonal antibodies in the future targeting BCMA, but the clinical development for this new approach of therapy is very exciting, because there are some even no bispecific, but even tri-specific monoclonal antibodies targeting not only BCMA, but maybe CD38, and together the C3 lymphocytes, in order to bring these T lymphocytes to the tumor niche. So definitely I think that the clinical development plan for the T-cell engagers is very exciting. Today, T-cell engagers are CAR-Ts, as well as the monoclonal antibodies, the conjugated monoclonal antibodies like belantamab, mafodotin, all of them are targeting BCMA. And well, the one appropriate question is how patients are going to proceed in order to choose CAR T versus T cell engagers versus conjugated monoclonal antibodies. And I think that disease-related factors as well as patient-related factors have to be considered in order to make the right choice. CAR-Ts are very attractive, but of course patients need to wait approximately 6 up to 7 weeks between the selection of the patient for CAR-T and the moment in which the patient finally received the CAR-T. because the T lymphocytes have to be modified, and this required approximately 4 or 5 weeks. T-cell engagers or bispecific monoclonal antibodies or belantamab mafodotin are off-the-shelf drugs, and this means that these drugs are going to be in the pharmacy of the hospital, and maybe some patients with a very aggressive relapse can wait to the CAR T, and it is possible to select these T-cell engagers or the conjugated monoclonal antibodies. But also travels, as well as patients' preferences, as well as hospital's availability have to be considered. But definitely I think that the BCMA is a target that maybe all patients with multiple myeloma will receive, maybe through T-cell engagers, bispecific monoclonal antibodies, conjugated monoclonal antibodies, or CAR-Ts. But BCMA monoclonal antibodies or BCMA targeted therapy will take part of the treatment of almost all patients with multiple myeloma.